Okay, once again, very good afternoon to one and all. So now let us see one more simple lab program for the Taylor series now. Okay, yes. So now let us understand the program's problem statement they have given. Develop a program to compute the sine x using the Taylor series approximation. So Taylor series, you're already familiar in the mathematics. With the help of that same Taylor series, we need to compute the sine of the particular angle. Okay, so compare your result with the built-in library function, print both the results with the appropriate messages. So we already know that the philosophy of the C programming is the usage of functions. So C programming functions are broadly classified into two types. First one is the library functions and another one is the user-defined functions. So C supports rich library, built-in library functions. Okay, one such function to find out the sine of an angle is the sine of sine function. So it helps in it helps the user to compute the sine of an angle. Okay, so here what they have mentioned is you should not use the built-in mathematical function, that is sine of an angle. Instead of that, use the Taylor series approximation to find out the sine of an angle and compare your result, whatever you have got from the Taylor series approximation, along with the built-in sine library function, built-in library function sine. So if it is equal, or if they are having a variation of one or two values, whatever it may be. So you need to print both the results with the appropriate messages. That means according to Taylor series, this is the value of the sine of an angle. According to the built-in library function, this is the value of the sine of an angle. Okay, so that is the problem statement here. Now, what is the input for this particular program? The input for this particular program is an angle. It is an angle basically. Okay, yes. So now, we have already seen how exactly the Taylor series is going to look like. So it basically looks like x minus x cube divided by 3 factorial plus x power 5 divided by 5 factorial minus x power 7 divided by 7 factorial up to so on. This is nothing but your Taylor series to find out the sine of an angle. Okay, yes. So with the help of this same sine series, now let us find out its sine of an angle and compare our result with the built-in sine function, and we will print both the appropriate messages. Before exactly how to see the output, let us have a brief recapitulation of how the program is going to work. So now, as we need to use the built-in mathematic function, here we need to include the mat.h header file along with the stdio.h. Okay, void main. Next one, int I. I is the looping variable. Next, here we have taken the variables by name degree float, degree comma, x comma, term comma sum. Degree comma, x comma, term comma sum. Okay, what is this degree? The input value, the input angle that is given by the user. Okay, x is nothing but the radian value, the radian actually. Okay, so if you have given the input in the form of degrees, that has to be converted to the radians. So how to find out the radian of an angle? It is degree into pi divided by 180. That is why x is to be used now. Next, term is nothing but the next term in the Taylor series. Don't get confused. Term is nothing but the next term in the Taylor series. Sum, the whole sum actually. Okay, to find out the sum each and every term. That is why sum has to be used. Now, the user is going to enter the value of the degrees. So once the user has entered the values in degrees, it has to be converted to the radians. Degree is equal, x is equal to degree into pi divided by 180. That is the formula. Now, we have got the radian value also. Now, let us start with the, building the Taylor series now. After building this Taylor series only, we can able to find out the sum. Okay, so now we have seen that how Taylor series looks like. It looks like x minus x cube divided by 3 factorial. What is the first term here? What is the first term? It is the x. That is why term has to be initialized to x. Okay, Taylor series starts from x minus x cube by 3 factorial plus x power 5 divided by 5 factorial minus x power 7 divided by 7 factorial, like that. That's why the first term is x. Initialize the term with x itself. Next one, sum is equal to term. That is nothing but the first one. First initial value of sum is nothing but the term. That's one. Okay. So once we are done with all these things, now start incrementing the series. Now start incrementing the series up to the number of terms you have taken. Here we have not explicitly enter the value of n and all. Here we have restricted our series up to the 20 terms. 20 terms. That's one. Now start with the iteration. Now the value of x is equal to 1 now. Okay, x power 1. First term is x power 1. Once after that one, x power I, it is nothing but x power I. I value was basically 1 in the term. Now in the Taylor series, if you observe, the next term is actually 3. That's why we have taken the looping variable is starting from 3. I is equal to 3. I less than or equal to 20. I is equal to I plus 2. Why I is equal to I plus 2 means first term was basically x power 1. X power 1. What is second term actually? It is x cube. How we got x cube actually? By adding x square. Correct, right? X power 1 plus x power 2. That is x power 3. That's why we have got. That is why we need to take up I plus 2. I is equal to I plus 2. Double the value. Once the condition is true, now find out the next term. Next term. So how to find out the next term? Term is equal to minus term. Why it is minus term? Because immediately after the first term, it is starting with minus. That's why x power 1 by 1 factorial minus x power 3 divided by 3 factorial. That is why. Okay. Yes. Minus term. Term value is x. Minus x into x into x. What is it? Minus x into x into x. It is minus x cube divided by. What is the value of I now? What is I basically? 3. 3 minus 1. 3 minus 1. That is 2. 2 into 3. What is 2 into 3? It is 6. What is 6? 3 factorial. 3 factorial. Okay. Yes. Sum is equal to sum plus term. Sum plus term. What is sum actually? Term. What is term? It is x. X. X plus. What is the value of the term we have got? It is minus 3 divided. Minus x power cube divided by 3 factorial. Correct, right? So that's why it is x minus x cube divided by 3 factorial. That is how it is going to work. Once again, I gets incremented. I is equal to 4. Similarly, term is equal to minus term into x. What is minus term here? The previous value. X cube. X cube into x. Correct, right? What is that one? It is x power 5. It is x power 5. Okay. Yes. Divided by 4 minus 1 into 4. 4 minus 1 is 3. 3 into 4. Like that. I gets incremented twice actually. So now I is equal to 5. I is equal to 5 now. I is equal to 5 minus term into, that is 3 x power x cube into x. That is, we have got x power 5 now, divided by I value is 5 now. 5 minus 1 is 4. 4 into I value is 5. Yes, that is it should be around it is around 5 minus 1, that is 4 into 5 20 into previous value 6, that is 120. Now that is 20 into 6 is 120. What is 120? It is 5 factorial. Thereby x minus x cube divided by 5 factorial plus x power 5 divided by 5 factorial. Thereby the series continues like that. Okay. Yes. Now that is how the program is going to work. So upon up to 20 terms, this loop is going to work. So now upon execution of this for loop, we are going to print the Taylor series value, that is my sign of percentage G, that is the angle whatever you have taken, the value it is going to obtain. Next one is using the built-in library function sign of percentage. Understand? So that is how this SineX Taylor series approximation program is going to work. Now let us see how exactly the output looks like. Okay, so now I will help you in running this particular program. Yes. Okay. So, cc space, the name of the file. See here, how to run this particular program. As we have used the mat.h header file, you have to continue with using the command -lm, and press enter. So now /a.out. So upon successful execution, we will type /a.out command. Now press enter. Now enter the values in degrees. Now let us give the value, some value, that is sine 45. Now according to Taylor series approximation, what is the value and what is the exact value of sine 45? Let us compare. Okay. Yes. Upon this one, we are going to get the same value. My sine of sine 45 is, my sine of 45 is nothing but according to the Taylor series approximation, it is my 0.7071. Using built-in sine function, it is also 0.70717. Okay, so our program is correct. Now let us take up one more input for negative angles, how it looks like. Let us take up for minus 45 itself. For minus 45, this is how the output looks like. Minus 45. Next one. For sine 90. For sine 90. What is sine 90? It is 1. Shall we check it? Yes. Sine 90 is 1. Next. Sine 0. What is sine 0? 0. Okay. So this is about your sine series and sine series, actually using the Taylor series approximation method, and we have compared our result with the built-in sine function also. Understand? Yes. So this is about the Taylor series program. Now we have one more program for this, one more simple program, that is your square root program, finding out the square root of a number. Finding the square root of a number without using the built-in function. So now let us understand the basic concept present here, and then let us run the program. Okay. So here also you need to find out the square root of a number without using the built-in library function. Okay. So first we need to find out the square root of a number without using the built-in function, and compare that value, whatever you have got, with the built-in library function, that is sqrt. Understand? If both are same, our program is working properly. Now let us see how it exactly works. Develop a program to find out the square root of a given number n and execute for all possible inputs with appropriate messages. They have given a clause, don't use the library function sqrt of n. Yes. Now what is the input for this particular program? Any number. For that particular number, we need to find out the square root of a number. Okay, so without using the built-in function, for example, let us take up the number as 100. What is the square root of 100? It is 10. You are already familiar with this. So for this, I will tell you to write a program for this. What you will write, simply you will use the built-in library function. Enter a number, scanf percentage d ampersand n, x is equal to square root of n, where x is nothing but the square root value it is going to store. Obviously, you will get the answer as 10. Now they have told, don't use the built-in library function. Then what will be the solution for this program? There is a solution. So we are going to make use of one popular method called as the Newton-Raphson method. The Newton-Raphson method, which helps in finding out the square root of a number without using the actual square root method. Okay, Newton-Raphson method, with the help of that one only, we are going to obtain the square root of a given number. For this, we are going to use the particular formula here. S is equal to S plus N by S divided, whole divided by 2. That is a standard formula actually. How it has come, we have already known that one. Okay, now let us see how exactly the program is going to work. As usual, mat.h has to be used because we are comparing our result with the built-in square root function. That is one. So now what is the input for this program? One number, that's all. Int I comma n double s. S is nothing but your square root. Enter the number, scanf percentage d ampersand n. So initialize the value of square root is equal to n. Initialize the value of square root is equal to n. If they have mentioned this condition, if n is greater than or equal to 0, if n is greater than or equal to 0, because there is no square root for a negative number, that's why. If n is greater than or equal to 0, if that particular condition is true, then it enters to the for loop. For I is equal to 1, I less than or equal to n into 2, I plus plus. Okay, so now let us take up n is equal to 4. N is equal to 4, let us take up. Okay, so 4 is greater than or equal to 0. So now what is the value of square root? S is equal to 4. S is equal to n. So S is equal to 4, obviously. If 4 is greater than or equal to 0, condition is true? Yes, absolutely true. Okay, now the program, the control comes to the for loop. For I is equal to 1, I less than or equal to, what is n into 2? 4 into 2, 8. Okay, yes. 1 is less than or equal to 8, condition is absolutely true. So it will enter into the for loop. S is equal to S plus N by S whole divided by 2. Now compute that particular formula. What is the value of S? 4 plus N divided by S. What is the value of N? It is 4. What is 4 by 4? It is 1. 4 plus 1 whole divided by 2. That is 5 divided by 2 is 2.5. Okay. Once again, I gets incremented. I is equal to 2. 2 less than or equal to 8. Condition is true. Once again. Now, check with the value of S. S is 2.5 now. S is 2.5. 2.5 plus 4 by 2 is 2. 2.5 plus 2 whole divided by 2. Some answer you will get. So, upon doing the iterations again and again, once you get the value nearer to 8 less than or equal to 8, you will be getting the exact square root value. What is the square root of 4? It is 2. Thereby, you will stop the iterations. Once you are done with everything, print the square root of the particular number. Okay? Yes. And using this library function also. That's all. So, if the condition is false, then it is going to come to the else part, thereby printing no square root to a negative. Understand? So now let us see how this program is going to work. Very, very simple program. Yes. Now let us copy this program. Square root of a number. Save root.c. I'm going to save it as root.c. So compile the program now. Compile the program CC space. Same step has to be followed, whatever we have seen in the Tyler series, because here also we have made use of mat.h, that's why root.c space minus lm. Okay, yes, press enter /a.out. Now enter the number 4. What is the square root of 2? What is the square root of 4? It is 2. Without using built-in function, you should get 2. Using built-in function, you should get 2. Let us see what happens. Okay, yes. Now let us take up one more number, 78, which is not a perfect square number. It is not a perfect square number, 78. It is 8.831 without using built-in function. With using built-in function also, the same result we have obtained. First one was perfect square. Second one is non-perfect square. Now let us take up a negative number. So if you take up negative number, what will be the result? No square root for a negative number. Yes, let us see that. Minus 90 I have taken. No square root to a negative number. Okay, so this is how the square root of a number particular number program works. Okay, so now we have seen two simple programs. First one is the Tyler series, other than is the square root of a number without using the built-in library function. Okay, so please run these two programs in your online GDB compiler and get the results. Once you get the results, copy those results in your observation book as well as in the record book. If you are having any doubts in tracing this particular program at any point of time, please feel free to contact me. I'll definitely help you in tracing this program once again. Okay, yes. So with this, we are ending this session. Once again, thank you all. Thank you so much.